did we learn to harness such power? In the late 800s, while King Alfred sat on the English throne, alchemists in China were searching for the secret of eternal life. A chance mix of ingredients led them instead to a lethal concoction. Gunpowder. Knowledge of their explosive discovery spread slowly along trading routes, through Asia and Arabia and on into the Mediterranean, to reach the West some 400 years later. In England, Roger Bacon, a Franciscan friar devoted to scholarship, came across the recipe buried deep in foreign manuscripts. Was terrified by the uses to which his discovery might be put. In an attempt to keep the formula a secret, he wrote it down only in code. A man is crazy who writes a secret unless he conceals it from the crowd, so that it can be understood only by the effort of the studious and the wise. Gunpowder's potential as a weapon of war was far too great to remain hidden. Knowledge soon spread through Europe, and a dangerous new art emerged. At first, people mixed gunpowder by hand, but by mid-1500, gunpowder mills began to spring up to meet the growing demand. Some needs were secret. Guy Fawkes probably used imported or illegal powder in his ill-fated attempt to blow up Parliament in 1605. We still mark this event each year on Bonfire Night. Remember, remember the 5th of November, gunpowder, treason and plot. In 1642, civil war broke out between royalists and parliamentarians, and the demand for gunpowder rocketed. The king set up more mills. Gunpowder manufacture began here in the 1660s, and for the next 300 years, Waltham Abbey played a major role in British history. Making gunpowder became a complex process, and successful manufacture was crucial to Britain's effective political and military development. In the late 1700s, William Congreve, Deputy Comptroller of the Royal Laboratory, Woolwich, urged the government to secure the Waltham Abbey mills for the nation. The high-quality powder from Waltham Abbey was vital to Nelson's victory at Trafalgar. And 10 years later, it was used with success by Wellington at Waterloo. British gunpowder was exported to America. But the British restricted supplies to the restless colony in an attempt to prevent the development of the War of Independence. A few decades later, the English were firing on them with a new lightweight rocket designed by William Congreve's son. This weapon proved so devastating that it was immortalized in the American national anthem. Independent America realized the importance of controlling its own gunpowder supplies. By the early 1800s, the DuPont family had established the Hagley Mills in Delaware. And some 50 years later, Lamont DuPont visited Waltham Abbey, taking many new ideas back with him.
Rapidly taking shape in the Black Hills of South Dakota is the Mount Rushmore National Memorial.
Firing at the enemy was not the only use for gunpowder. The great engineer, Isambard Kingdom Brunel, used a ton a week to blast his way through rock for the Great Western Railway Line, completing his Great Box Tunnel in 1841. Gunpowder has shaped the landscape as well as the course of military history. The reign of gunpowder was drawing to an end. The competition to fire larger projectiles to a more destructive end meant that guns became bigger and bigger, some weighing more than 100 tons, using huge amounts of gunpowder and enveloping everything in a cloud of smoke when fired. The 1800s was a time of scientific revolution, and a new breed of chemists were experimenting with new types of explosives. One of these was gun cotton. First discovered by continental chemists, it was Britain's Sir Frederick Abel who devised the first safe manufacturing process, here at Waltham Abbey. Similarly, the powerful explosive nitroglycerin was too dangerous to use easily. Close attention was required in the nitration process. Alfred Nobel, from Sweden, found a way of harnessing it safely. Combining nitroglycerin and gun cotton was found to produce a powerful propellant, which was safe to handle. Developed as cordite, it is still in use today. There were many accidental explosions during manufacture, and rules were necessarily strict. Workers were encouraged to work at a leisurely pace rather than risk mistakes, and a special police force searched their pockets for items that could spark an explosion, such as cigarettes, pipes, and tinderboxes. During the First World War, cordite and other high explosives completely changed the nature of battle. Both sides fired off vast quantities of ammunition in an attempt to blast the other into submission, in the war to end all wars. Here at Waltham Abbey, as elsewhere, the efforts of thousands of women employed to manufacture explosives helped secure the Allied victory in 1918. I never realized till you had gone how much I cared about you. I can't. During the Second World War, high explosives brought terror to the civilian populations of Europe, as well as their armies. many other factories close to London, Waltham Abbey was deemed an easy target for German planes. In 1943, production ceased and manufacture moved away from the southeast. Nevertheless, Waltham Abbey produced a new material called RDX, the powerful explosive used in the bouncing bomb designed by Barnes Wallis for the Dambusters raid. Research continued at Waltham Abbey after the war. Much of this still remains secret. But it shaped the use of explosives as we know them today, and played a significant role in wider developments, such as ejector seat technology and materials such as the protective armor Kevlar. Internationally, research into propellants and rocket science undertaken here helped put man in space. We have come a long, long way in our understanding and use of explosives since those Chinese alchemists made their chance discovery. But it still retains its ancient power to terrify and to enchant us.